This is chapter 19 of Lords of the Press by George Seldes, and this is Rejected Knowledge. Chapter 19, Northwest, Liberal Despite the Press. It is a fact that the liberal American tradition rolled westward with the covered wagons. It is also unfortunately true that, to a certain extent, the movement which drained the East of so much of its daring blood also drained it considerably of its progressive spirit. It is not so much the fact that Maine and Vermont voted against the Roosevelt deal as the New England attitude against any sort of New Deal. The cities and states which produced the great libertarians now sound the alarm when their descendants repeat their great ideas further west. One would naturally expect the press would reflect the character of the religion. Boston, with its cheap politicians, its narrow-minded masses, its prejudices against art and literature, and its domination by a few banks and corporations, can no longer be expected to produce magnificent, enlightened mass-circulation newspapers, but the Northwest, Oregon, Washington, Idaho, and Montana, where the liberal spirit finds most favorable soil, ought as a corollary to produce newspapers at least as liberal as its politics. The spirit of equality and democracy lingers over from covered wagon days and is reflected in much of the liberal legislation of those votes. The right of the people to vote directly on issues, the initiative and referendum, had its baptism in the Pacific Northwest, where it soon became known as the Oregon system and spread to half the states of the nation. Similarly, Oregon instituted the direct election of United States senators before that principle was embodied in the federal constitution. The recall of public officials, minimum wage laws, maximum hours of labor, public ownership of hydroelectric power, old age pensions, all of these found fertile soil in the vast Northwest. From the Northwest have come such enlightened senators as the late Harry Lane, who, with five others, voted against America's declaration of war. Thomas J. Walsh and William E. Borah carried the liberal traditions of the Oregon country into the senatorial chambers, and today, Louis B. Schwellenbach, junior senator from Washington, is among the staunchest supporters of the New Deal. By and large, the congressional delegations of these states are far more liberal than the national average, and nowhere, except perhaps in the solid South, has the president stronger backing than in the states surrounding Puget Sound. Everyone in the Northwest will admit that it is a progressive region. Even Oregon's, quote, 9-foot hotel bedsheet law, unquote, is sheepishly hailed as a forward step in sanitation. But none of the residents attribute the liberal policies of the Pacific Northwest to the influence of the press. Progress has been made in spite of the newspapers, not because of them. Today, few newspapers in the four states have any vestige of the pioneering spirit that marked the old independent editors who set up hand presses and type cases alongside the stage relay station or land office. The papers of the Northwest, with pathetically few exceptions, fight all reforms as tenaciously as the chain-ridden press of New England. In common with the newspapers of the rest of the nation, the Northwest dailies ridicule the New Deal, malign the president, and belittle and besmirch all attempts at progressive and reform legislation. Repeatedly, the people have repudiated the concerted efforts of the press to preserve the status quo. It is a byword, for instance, that whatever candidate the newspapers unite for will be soundly trounced. Three times the press of Oregon tried to saddle the people with a sales tax. Once it was under the guise of relieving property owners, the next time to keep the schools from closing, and finally, Social Security growing popular, to provide funds for old age pensions. Each time the sales tax was licked, and each time by a bigger margin. The influence of the editorial page, pride of the elders of the Fourth Estate, has waned in the Northwest. A flickering bright spot in the fog of journalistic commercialism is the few weeklies that maintain the tradition of old, when editors set their own type and wrote their own editorials. Most of the country sheets, it is true, are splotchy conglomerations of boilerplate and canned editorials with a few columns of locals as an excuse for publication. But around the four states, a number of editors still believe in trying to print what they believe. CIO and Commonwealth Federation papers once a week tell the stories the press associations ignore. No more refreshing oasis in the newspaper desert can be found than the Salem Capital Press, edited by a picturesque old man named A.M. Church, who wears a battered eye shade and slashes away at his fellow newspapermen with relish. No one has more contempt for the quote-unquote venal press than this old non-partisan leaguer from North Dakota, who delights in rattling the political skeletons so carefully preserved among the sacred cows of his conservative colleagues. The Colonel has the largest weekly in the Northwest and insults potential power company and bank advertisers and manages to keep up the payments on his linotype machine. Two full pages of classified ads from the farmers of the valley are the backbone of his independence. A jug full of quarters under the counter, collected from farmers and swappers for their livestock ads, keep him going through the Depression. Colonel Church is the burr under the Oregon editor's saddle. Progressives look to his new rotary press to make his paper the liberal voice of the state, just as La Follette's progressive is in Wisconsin. The slightest offense by any liberal or progressive is seized upon greedily by the majority of the newspapers of this great progressive part of the country. When an automobile driven by Harry Bridges killed a boy in an accident, the mishap was blazoned in screaming headlines. Bridges was later cleared of blame. But when the young scion of Portland's wealthiest department store family was convicted of a felony in a California court, the people of the city did not learn about it through their newspapers. The vigilant defenders of the freedom of the press were too busy to print that news. It was published in other cities where that particular department store, the largest in Portland, did not buy advertising. The most active of Oregon's newspapers politically is the Oregon Journal. Its principal owner is Philip L. Jackson, known about the town as Phil. He inherited the paper from his father, who built it into a powerful publication by being for battling Bob La Follette and Harry Lane and Tom Walsh and other progressives in public life. I hate that term, progressive. But Phil inherited only the paper and not these enlightened tendencies. He is a playboy sort of fellow who loves to play at being, quote-unquote, admiral at various regattas held to publicize commercialized beach and lake resorts. The Journal could not find space to tell its readers what happened to the son of the great department store family, but it always manages to devote plenty of space to a picture of Admiral Phil surrounded by the toothsome beauties who comprise his lovely crew. Various other of Phil's enlightened deeds, such as giving a water cart to the university football team, a professional outfit largely recruited from other states, are amply publicized in the newspaper he inherited. Where once the stern, socially useful news of the elder La Follette were heralded in the journal, the paper's readers now learn about Fleet Week and the gay party Phil has given for the visiting naval officers. For a time, the journal, being a democratic newspaper, pretended to be for the New Deal, but as the president steadily adopted liberal policies, the sham ended. Phil made the paper's real hero, Governor Charles H. Martin, probably the most reactionary man ever to hold public office in the Far West. After being elected by posing as a friend of President Roosevelt, Martin, a retired major general, turned into a virtual autocrat. He inferentially commended the handling of labor problems by Hitler and Mussolini. He advised the state police to move against labor pickets and, quote, beat hell out of them, unquote, and crack their damn heads, quote, unquote. And he assailed the New Deal with such temperate language as remarking he would like, quote, to kick the pants off the National Labor's Relation Board, unquote. The journal made this hero its own, and conveniently neglected to print Martin's advice to a sheriff's convention. Quote, the Italians wouldn't submit. They organized their black shirts. The Germans wouldn't submit. So they had their brown shirts and Hitler. I don't think the Americans will submit, unquote. Wow. What a wild man, huh? And that was a governor of Washington State? Oh, wow. When Martin ran for renomination in the Democratic primaries recently, the journal descended to new depths of journalistic indecency. The rumor spread around the state that President Roosevelt was about to thrust at the militaristic governor who had run out on the New Deal. Martin's furious denial was smeared at the top of page one. The president's thrust at Martin a few days later was shoved into an inconspicuous head. Ralph Watson, Phil's slavishly reactionary political writer, was turned loose to smear Henry Hess, the progressive nominee. A Hess meeting attended by 2,500 people was ridiculed as a washout in the journal. A Martin gathering attended by 400 was an enthusiastic success. The whole paper became a house organ for this fascist-minded militarist. Martin's victory was confidently predicted by the willing Watson. The governor's tour through crucial Clackamas County was heralded in the journal as a trip of triumph and success. Hess's reception was contrasted for its bleakness. On election day, Hess won decisively. Newspapers are always looking for scoops, but not when the scoop augurs well for liberalism. The Portland News-Telegram of the Scripps-Canfield chain buys the, quote, Washington merry-go-round, unquote, column by the widely known liberal writers Drew Pearson and Robert S. Allen. Shortly before the Martin Hess election, their column predicted that the New Deal was washed up with Martin's reactionary policies. It was a clean beat, and preceded by nearly a week, a direct attack on Martin led by the president, Secretary Ickes, and Senator Norris. It was a national scoop. The News-Telegram killed it in Portland. The people of Oregon would never have known about the column had not the Oregonian, A rival newspaper, seen it elsewhere and reprinted it. The News Telegram is one of the Northwest's most militant defenders of the freedom of the press. Its editor, Tom Shea, is a former football game official. The Oregonian, at Portland, is one of the strange newspapers on America's last frontier. It is extremely unobjective and biased in its attitude toward the New Deal. But it also is one of the few papers in the country that sincerely champions the liberties of the underdog. It led a campaign which resulted finally in the Supreme Court decision outlawing Oregon's abortive criminal syndicalism law. It also has been more outspoken than any other paper on the Pacific Coast in its defense of the Spanish loyalists. The Oregonian sponsored a crusade in Portland which resulted in the curtailment and abolition of that city's vicious police Red Squad. In both editorials and feature stories, the paper showed that the Red Squad was financed by leading lumber barons and anti-union employers who wanted to prevent the organization of their employees. The editor of the Oregonian is a liberal of the old school named Paul Kelty. He fears that the New Deal has taken away liberty, and he looks back to the day that is gone. The day when a merchant owning a cornerstone could thrive and succeed and prosper and become a successful man. Kelty works with the Civil Liberties Union in Portland, and vigilante activities always draw his fire. His editorials lambasting the Dyes Committee were the best in the far west along that line. The Oregonian also conducts its news columns objectively and refuses to make them propaganda for special interests. For the past decade or so, the Oregonian has been held under a trust. Now the trust is coming to an end, and the ownership of the paper will revert to a group of wealthy families. They seem to have their eyes on the main chance, and already have enlisted the services of the eminent ex-Hearst efficiency expert, Guy T. Wisniewski, who is expected to make a lot of recommendations which may improve the paper as a commercial venture, but certainly not as a purveyor of information. The high hopes for a liberal journalistic force in the Northwest, which were occasioned by the appointment of the president's son-in-law as editor of the Seattle Post-Intelligencer, have given way to pessimism and sour laughter. Incidentally, the first persons who expressed their doubts about John Bottiger were his employees. The newspaper writers have had difficulties with their new boss, and it is their opinion that any employer who cannot make a satisfactory deal with his men and win their friendship is no friend of labor, and therefore his position as a progressive and a liberal must be ambiguous. Hearst chose Bottiger after the 1936 election. Bottiger had been one of the Chicago Tribune's Washington New Deal baiting crew. Apparently he was fighting Franklin D. Roosevelt while courting Anna Roosevelt Dahl, but once given the editorship of the Post-Intelligencer, it was expected that there would be a change in Bottiger's political viewpoint. Unfortunately, however, Bottiger made his first alliances with Dave Beck, the American Federation of Labor boss, and Mayor Dorr, two of the most powerful enemies of the progressive labor movement in America. In his new book, Our Promised Land, which magnificently tells the story of the Northwest, Richard L. Neuberger explains the failure of the new editor to live up to liberal expectations. Bottiger, writes Neuberger, quote, has been in frequent skirmishes with the National Labor Relations Board because of his refusals to bargain with the American Newspaper Guild. Each time he appears before the board, some of Seattle's citizens muse on the curious fact that he is the son-in-law of the most important advocate of collective bargaining in the nation's history, unquote. A lumberjack wrote in The Timber Worker that he had encountered hard-boiled bosses in the woods, but none tougher than the president's son-in-law. Whether Dave Beck took Bottiger into camp, or vice versa, is unimportant, but, quote, the two are now boon companions, and apparently it pays, unquote, reported the Washington merry-go-round. And the Guild reporter noted that when Pegler wrote some columns attacking Beck's kind of labor movement, they were, quote, omitted and distorted in Bottiger's newspaper, unquote. Neuberger gives most amusing details of how both Bottiger and his wife, writing her homemakers section under the name Anna Roosevelt, exploit both the president and Mrs. Eleanor Roosevelt in their news and feature columns. But when it comes to real support to the important policies and reforms which the president initiates, or the first lady advocates, the Bottigers, who cannot, of course, join the anti-New Deal press in howling, content themselves with support which is, quote-unquote, scarcely perfunctory. Two great topics agitate the progressive Northwest: electric power and lumber. It is to the public benefit that power remain publicly owned and that the lumber companies do not destroy all the timber. But if the policies of newspapers are studied, it will be found that they are usually on the side of the privately owned electric light and timber corporations. The most recent example of timber control of Washington newspapers, outside routine strike news coverage, which is not peculiar to Washington, is the position they took in the Olympic National Park question. Conservationists wanted to save the last stand of giant fir and hemlock in the West, but lumbermen looked with avaricious eyes upon those giant trees, some 40 feet in circumference, centuries old when Columbus discovered America. The newspapers lined up solidly. Including the timber in the park, they said editorially, was not for the public welfare. Ikes was misquoted, and when he protested, Bottiger attacked Ikes, but later he incorporated, in his own banquet speech, some phrases made by the Secretary of the Interior. The darkest chapters in the history of Washington State, the Centralia and Everett massacres, are properly laid at the door of the timbermen's fight against union organization of sawmills and logging camps. Both massacres were whitewashed by the press. In Centralia, vigilantes, including members of an American Legion post, lynched a member of the Industrial Workers of the World after torturing him for a day and a night. The Business Chronicle, weekly mouthpiece for the open shoppers, now thought the lid was off. It printed an editorial called The Thing, The Cause, The Cure. The editorial read, quote, real Americans must rise as one man in righteous wrath. Smash un-American, anti-American organization in the land. Put to death the leaders and imprison for life aiders and abettors. Deport aliens, unquote. Wow. Now that is reactionary. That sounds Hitlerian. Wow. These are your business leaders, folks. This editorial, published by the Open Shop Weekly, was presented to the Post-Intelligencer, which prepared to run it on the editorial page without even a paid advertising added. The printers gasped and called a chapel meeting. They passed a resolution. It read, quote, "We have been patient under misrepresentation, faithful in the face of slander, long-suffering under insult. Little by little, as our patience seemed unbounded, your editorial and business policy encroached upon and further overstepped bonds not only of fairness and truth, but decency and Americanism itself. But there is a limit to all things." Unquote. The printing trades at the Post-Intelligencer told the publisher either to pull that editorial, call back all the early editions in which it appeared, or there wouldn't be any more newspapers printed for quite a while. The Post-Intelligencer pulled the editorial, called back the early editions, and printed an apology. Edwin Selvin, publisher of the Business Chronicle, was arrested by federal agents a few days later for violating Section 211 of the Penal Code for, quote, "tending to incite murder and assassination," unquote. Well, thank the Lord. Somebody's finally calling these guys to account. Well, that was a historical anomaly there. It was not until 1935 that lumber workers won. Yeah, but I bet he just got slapped on the wrist and let go. It was not until 1935 that lumber workers won their fight for an 8-hour day and union recognition. Governor Martin dispatched state troops with guns and gas to the largest lumber mill in the world, the St. Paul and Tacoma Lumber Company, a Weyerhaeuser mill at Tacoma. Toll of the strikers was 2 dead, 24 beaten, 396 arrested, 100 pickets, and 300 bystanders gassed. Toll of the strikebreakers, 9 beaten, windows broken, rotten eggs thrown. Despite this tabulation, all the newspapers gave an impression that violence was committed by the strikers. Sounds to me like they got the hell beat out of them, and they threw a few rotten eggs and broke some windows. And, wow, they got the hell beaten out of them for that, and, yeah, man. But they're the bad guys, huh? That's what happens when you're not on the power of, on the side of money power. A sample of the headlines run by the Post-Intelligencer follows. Protection of workers guaranteed by Governor Martin. Guards rout Tacoma Reds. Troops called to halt mill strikes. The Times. Rioters routed with bayonets after mobbing 3 mill workers. The Star. Workers rout union leaders. The strikers won, however, union recognition and a minimum wage of 62.5 cents an hour. How about a maximum wage? When are we going to go after that? If there's got to be a minimum wage, how about a maximum wage? Obviously, I'm throwing that in there. But how about it? Maximum wage. You never hear about that one spoken of, huh? The newspapers have been attempting to get Harold J. Pritchett, youthful president of the International Woodworkers of America, who led the strike, deported to Canada ever since. The Scripps League of Papers, not connected with the Scripps Howard chain, but an outgrowth of another chain formed by E.W. Scripps, made a bid for circulation by championing the quote-unquote underdog, the underpaid. The Seattle Star indulged in this public service so long as the editorial workers writing the stuff did so at $12 and $15 a week. But the newspaper guild came along. Better wages were asked. On July 2nd, 1937, 19 men were fired for refusing to quit the guild. The NLRB ordered their reinstatement, and the Seattle Star had to pay about $30,000 in salaries. It now fights the New Deal and defends no underdog. In the congressional record for May 2, 1938, Senator Schwellenbach accused the Star of perpetrating a newspaper hoax intended to destroy him and Senator Bone politically by quoting them with Senator Nye, Dr. Moulton of Brookings Institute, and others as favoring its plan for the abandonment of Roosevelt's power development program. Said Schwellenbach, quote, "I think that those who are in public life today are entitled to some measure of protection against newspapers which, without responsibility, apparently without the slightest regard for the truth, and without the slightest regard for the real position of those in public office, attempt to put into their mouths words which were never uttered," unquote. The Star apologized and blamed a press association. The press of the Pacific Northwest is to a large degree the same as elsewhere. The difference is, in the Northwest, that only one or two newspapers approach the objectivity of such Eastern publications as the Christian Science Monitor and the New York Times. Another difference is that the papers of the Northwest have virtually lost all their influence. President Roosevelt carried the region about 2-1 in 1936 with scarcely any newspaper support. The sales tax sponsored by the newspapers has been voted down by margins as high as 6-1, a legislative measure to force students to pay a compulsory fee to support the university football team was favored by nearly every paper in Oregon, except the Oregonian, yet at a referendum at the polls, it lost by a margin of better than 3-1. Such men in public office as Senator Schwellenbach and Jerry O'Connell of Montana never have newspaper support, yet they win consistently. In many parts of the Northwest, men running for office boast that certain newspapers are against them. On this basis, they assure the people that they must be acting in the public interest, or else those particular papers would not be against them. The Pacific Northwest is, according to Secretary Ickes, one of America's progressive spots. He says the East looks to it for liberal guidance. That liberalism exists not because of the region's newspapers, but because the people have learned not to believe those newspapers. Okay, folks, that was Chapter 19 of Lords of the Press by George Seldes from 1938. We'll be back with Chapter 20 in a few. We're back. And this is Chapter 20. Of Lords of the Press by George Seldes from 1938. Chapter 20, Speaker in the House of Lords. For several years now, the publishers of America have chosen James Geddes Stallman of the National Banner as their spokesman and president. Stallman has been the traveling orator, the vocal upholder of what is known as freedom of the press in ownership circles. Quote, "The press of this country is not venal," unquote, is one of his favorite expressions. At the Herald Tribune Forum, he told how brave the New York Times had been in exposing Boss Tweed generations ago. Yeah, I bet they didn't expose Boss Tweed's bosses, though. Mm-mm. And other brave acts in distant cities. He himself is noted for having conducted a crusade against loan sharks, and he would no doubt bravely engage in another against the man-eating, non-advertising Bengal tiger. Nor is this sneer unfair. Let us look at two or three items in the record of the man chosen to represent the publishers of America. Does he publish all the news or suppress what he does not like? Do financial interests enter into the conduct of his own newspaper? Is he fair to labor? Is he liberal, progressive, or reactionary? Is he editorially on the side of the public or the public utilities? In answering some of these questions, we may be able to learn something of the relationships of the many parts of a complex system which, because of a plethora of names, it may be best to label merely the status quo. It is not my object to make out any personal devils in this investigation into the behaviorism of the lords of the press. As a certain Euripides said long ago, let the facts speak for themselves. Very appropriately, journalistically as well as ethically, the newspaper guild investigated the record of the man who was leading the embattled publishers in their fight against the reporters. Since Stallman, traveling up and down the country, was beating his breast every time he cried, "Freedom of the press!" the guild went to work on the supposition that he was running a free newspaper back home. Free, that is, in the sense that it served the public, not the interests. The first guild report, it was followed by numerous others, alleging suppression and distortion of news, makes three charges against Stallman, to wit, 1. Published an article viciously maligning the reputation of the late Mrs. Florence Kelly, one of the leaders in the fight for the child labor amendment, in an attempt to blacken the amendment in the eyes of his readers, and then refused to print an answer and correction from Newton D. Baker. 2. Suppressed all mention of the recent beatings of the CIO organizer in Memphis, Norman Smith, despite the fact that the story was nationwide news and appeared on many front pages not only in other cities, but in his own rival, the Tennessean. Also, despite the fact that his paper has consistently tried to represent the CIO as given to violence. 3. Edited the news of the Chicago Memorial Day Massacre film to distort its revelations about the police and cut the piece down to a 2-inch story on the back page. The attack on Florence Kelly was made with the aid of a committee from the Sentinels of the Republic, quote, one of America's leading fascist organizations, unquote, which had labeled the famous leader a communist. The banner used the headline, National Welfare Organization Brands Child Labor Proposal as Work of Communist Leaders. Newton Baker protested. He said in his letter that Florence Kelly was, quote, a very great and very noble woman, intellectually the greatest woman I have ever known, unquote. But the leading apostle of freedom of the press refused the former Secretary of War space for a correction. Summing up its report, the Guild said of Stallman that, quote, in his own paper he publishes contemptible distortions. He traduces the memory of great characters when it serves his ends, and when the truth gets in his way, he suppresses it, unquote. Like many sincere men and many hypocrites who proclaim themselves as liberal, when in heart and truth they are reactionaries and even worse, James G. Stallman proclaims himself a friend of labor, when all his actions prove him to be the enemy of labor. He resents that classification. In one of his press association orations, he called, quote, editorial dishonesty, unquote, an editorial in an unnamed paper which said Stallman is, quote, one of the most rabid open shoppers in the country, unquote. Recently, liberal weeklies have published a photostat of a letter in which Stallman's banner asks that non-union men only be sent for jobs in the typographical department. He cannot deny that his paper broke the union there, refused to employ union men, fought the unions and maintained an anti-union editorial policy, but he gets angry when he is called an open shopper. The Nashville Banner locked out its employees in 1929 and imported a gang of strikebreakers. The management refused to hire composing room workers without first checking their pasts for evidence of pro-union tendencies. Union men had no chance. This condition prevailed up to August 1937, when the Newspaper Guild made an investigation, but in December of that year, La Follette's Progressive reported that the Newspaper Printing Corporation, which prints both the Banner and the Tennessean, did sign a contract with the Printing Pressmen's Union, and adds that Stallman is, quote, violently anti-New Deal and anti-labor, unquote. The Guild goes further and charges the Banner with serving, quote, as an informal clearinghouse for strike-breaking typesetters, unquote. Two documents support the charge. First, there is the Banner letter which contains the statement, quote, naturally, the thing we wish to avoid is the placing of workers with union sympathies. So, if, the name of the man seeking the job, has any sympathy for the union that you know of, we would be particularly interested in the most complete information you care to give us, unquote. The second is the signed statement of the president of the Nashville Typographical Union, Robert Cuthbert, who describes the, quote, lockout of the composing room of the Nashville Banner, of which James G. Stallman, president of the American Newspaper Publishers Association, is publisher, unquote. It continues, quote, the only alleged reason for that act was that, after the paper's contractual relations extending over a period of 40 years or more, Mr. Stallman posted a notice in the composing room stating that on Monday following, the wage paid in the composing room would be at a rate of 12 cents per 1,000 ems, an arbitrary figure, even at that date wholly inadequate, with no provisions for any method of determining details of such a practice. At the moment the notice was posted, Mr. Stallman had quartered, in a local hotel nearby, a large number of professional strikebreakers obtained through arrangement with the H.W. Flagg Agency. The Typographical Union made every honorable effort to reach an amicable settlement with the Banner, but Mr. Stallman has declared consistently that he never would employ members of the Typographical Union in the composing room of the Banner. Aside from his own paper's anti-labor attitude, Mr. Stallman sponsors and foments every effort possible against any organization of labor and every so-called New Deal activity or legislation. The Banner loses no opportunity to denounce and to issue derogatory statements about the present administration in Washington. It editorializes all news items affecting any labor matters, unquote. This is the record of the man who, as president of the Publishers Association, was chosen by them to fight the Newspaper Guild. When the ANPA convened in 1938, Stallman was re-elected president. He made another oration, this time charging that, quote, labor generally has been extremely obstreperous, unquote. He had no criticism of the older labor unions, he said, although his lockout was directed against one of the oldest AF-L unions, but he was opposed to, quote, certain movements which the press of this country considers inimical, not solely to its welfare, but contrary to the interests of a free people and to the preservation of free institutions in a democracy, unquote. As the CIO Newspaper Guild is the only new labor movement, it was understood that Stallman was lining up the press against both the CIO and the Guild. He was also opposed to taxes. So, in fact, were most men who make enough to pay them. In 1938, the Nashville Banner and the Nashville Tennessean made a working agreement. It was for their mutual benefit. It was called cooperation, and what economic crimes are committed in that name nowadays. And publishers everywhere applauded. But the latter newspaper dropped 8 men from its editorial department, and 8 or 10 from its business and circulation departments, and the Banner also discharged many employees. But that was not news. Nor was it news for the editor and publisher and other spokesmen of the owners that the commercial arrangements of the two rival newspapers in an important southern city also put the dominant business interests in control of all the means of journalistic power. As the Guild reporter pointed out, it said, quote, "The coalition includes notably men prominent in power and utilities industries. The TVA fight is hot in Nashville. And in banking, in addition to the newspaper industry itself. If presence on the board of directors of the same bank is evidence of close interests, as it probably is, the circle would take in even such individuals as heads of nationally known patent medicine companies," unquote. The rivalry between the Banner and Tennessean began to end when Paul M. Davis, president of the American National Bank, bought the Tennessean at a federal receivership sale. Davis is a friend of Stallman's. He had also been a director of the Tennessee Electric Light Company, and it may be a coincidence that Stallman has been friendly to this public utility. It is interesting to note that in an attempt to get the Tennessean back, its former owner filed a brief in which it stated that, quote, "Defendant avers that on account of the position of said Paul M. Davis as responsible head of large financial institutions, it has been essential for the said Paul M. Davis to suppress publication of legitimate news items regarding the matters set out herein above, and other matters of similar nature," unquote. The conflict between privately owned utilities and the TVA is then mentioned, and the brief continues, quote, "The said Paul M. Davis has been active in assisting, in hindering, delaying, and obstructing the objects and purposes of the TVA. The defendant is informed, and therefore charges that, as part of such obstructive tactics, the control of the press is important and essential, and for that reason, both the Power Company, of which the said Paul M. Davis is a director, and the said Paul M. Davis want the properties of the defendant to be acquired by the said Paul M. Davis," unquote. After the filing of this brief, Davis resigned as utility director. Said the Guild reporter, quote, Stallman is a close crony of J.P.W. Brown, vice president of the Tennessee Electric Power Company. These two, and John J. Edgerton, formerly president of the National Association of Manufacturers, and still a power in it, figure together in many local and state activities. Stallman's paper constantly reflects the close identity of interest with the big power, utility, and manufacturing concerns. Unquote. There is a large file of evidence. An anti-labor policy, of course, is usually the giveaway of a big business policy, and the Nashville newspapers, despite their shrill denials, are known by union men as their enemies. The Banner always plays up the pro-private utility news, but had no mention of a report by the State Utilities Commissioner, which revealed that the private corporations were paying huge sums to attorneys to fight TVA, charging these dollars to operating costs, which meant high rates and public loss. Quote unquote, "Moreover," continues the survey made by the Guild reporter, quote, "the Banner uses material by known propagandists for special causes without revealing the source. It ran an article pleading the cause of the private power companies by Dr. Gus W. Dyer of Vanderbilt University. Dyer is one of the 8 professional writers for the 6-Star Service, a service paid for by the National Association of Manufacturers and furnished to papers without cost." Unquote. The Tennessean, in many respects, represents a more liberal and progressive appearance. It has actually published several stories which criticize the utilities and others with a friendly labor tone, but it was neutral in the 1936 elections. Stallman, Banker Brown, and Tycoon Edgerton form a powerful group on the Board of Trustees of Vanderbilt University, where they are charged with reactionary militancy against all attempts at liberalism by the faculty. They have been accused of proposing the dismissals of professors and even the abolition of certain liberal departments. The ramifications of big business, the press, the utilities, higher learning, and the church were further exposed recently when an attempt was made to start a religious revival in Nashville. The way the two newspapers and big business went about it was so crude that its innate hypocrisy overwhelmed it. The idea was announced by Banker Brown at a Chamber of Commerce meeting. It was proposed to issue a quote-unquote call to righteousness, in which the leading ministers, the Chamber of Commerce, there you go, commerce, ministers, it's all the same, and the two newspapers would cooperate for the purpose of stilling the labor unrest in the 100 leading industrial plants of the section. The Banner and Tennessean did not publish this fact, of course, but issued the religious appeal later without mentioning the ulterior motive. But the CIO unions and the Nashville labor advocate denounced the entire business, and the National Weekly, the Christian Century, in an editorial which said that, quote, "the besetting sin of religion is hypocrisy," unquote, added that, quote, "this particular reflection is suggested by a recent news report in the Nashville Tennessean describing the call to righteousness among the half dozen leaders of the movement. One notes the names of J.P.W. Brown, Vice President of the Tennessee Electric Power Company, and a vigorous opponent of organized labor for many, many years. C.C. Gilbert, long-time secretary of the Tennessee Manufacturers Association, and as hard-boiled an enemy of every effort to ameliorate the lot of the workers and their women and children as could be found. And Leonard Sisk, also with the Tennessee Electric Company, and a leader in red-baiting circles. The thing which lies back of these men's concern for Nashville's righteousness is fear of the growing unrest among Nashville's labor, unquote. The relationship between newspapers and fraudulent medicinal advertisements was recently aired in a dispute between Ewan L. Davis, brother of Norman H. Davis, Mr. Roosevelt's ambassador at large, and of Paul M. Davis, owner of the Tennessean, and Paul M. Ward, Washington correspondent. Ward had written in praise of Edward R. Keyes, who had used the Tennessean as an example of a newspaper publishing advertising making the same fraudulent claims for bad medicine 2 years after the Federal Trade Commission, of which Ewan L. Davis was chairman, had issued its cease and desist orders. Ewan Davis protested that Brother Paul, quote, never owned the Nashville Tennessean, nor any stock therein, nor had exercised any control whatever of the Nashville Tennessean at the time any of the advertisements in question appeared, or either the Keys or the Ward article was published, unquote. Correspondent Ward replied, quote, I have before me an official statement by Jesse H. Jones, as chairman of the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, which notes, under date of October 31, 1935, that the RFC had some time before that date sold $250,000 worth of the Nashville Tennessean's bonds to Mr. Paul Davis as president of the American National Bank of Nashville, and that this brought the bank's total holdings to $460,000 out of the $750,000 in bonds outstanding, the bank having previously owned $210,000 worth. I think that settles the point as to who owns the Nashville Tennessean, unquote. Mr. Ward went farther, offering more copies of the advertisements in question after March 1937, when Ewan admits Paul officially became the proprietor. Mr. Ward claims the obnoxious advertisements appeared in many newspapers which replied affirmatively to the letters sent out by William P. Jacobs of Jacobs Religious Lists and the Institute of Medicine Manufacturers, urging pressure on newspapers to defeat the Tugwell Bill. Having made a thorough study of the Tennessean, Mr. Ward notes, quote, that among the directors or advisory board members of Mr. Paul Davis's bank are Bowling Warner, J.M. Gray, and F.M. Bass, men of the same names and Tennessee addresses are active figures in the patent medicine industry. One heads the Warner Drug Company, manufacturer of Renfrew salts for gout and rheumatism. Another is the manufacturer of Gray's ointment, the erstwhile cancer cure, which occupies a prominent position in the Food and Drug Administration's Chamber of Horrors. Attorney Bass has represented the manufacturer of Gray's ointment in proceedings before federal agencies, unquote. Mr. Ward concludes by asking Mr. Ewan Davis, quote, why FTC control of advertising has been a flop? Why the worst frauds in the food and drug racket are fighting to keep advertising control vested in the FTC, unquote. It is hardly necessary, after the presentation of the foregoing facts, to draw a moral. If we admit that Stallman and Davis are representative, sincere patriots, fanatical devotees of a free press, the picture of today's journalism is more than clouded, it is actually hopeless. But if we take them for what their actions show them to be, good businessmen making money out of newspapers in complete disregard of the ethical overtones of the profession, then we have a very fair clue to what is the matter with the press and why the American people have a suspicion that newspapers are biased against labor and in favor of the utilities, why they speak more often for the banks and big business than for the common man, why they frequently suppress the news and more frequently color it. In short, why the publishers of America run their newspapers as big business instead of, quote, the palladium of liberty, unquote, as they continue to say on their mastheads. Okay, folks, those were chapters 19 and 20 from Lords of the Press by George Seldes from 1938. You've been listening to Rejected Knowledge.